morning, Uplift Church, wherever you may be at worshiping, we are just so glad that you're able to join us as we open up God's Word together and just serve Him. And I'm telling you, I'm just excited about this morning. It's kind of unusual because Wednesday I was wearing a hoodie, and you know, right now it's nearly 80 degrees. And so, you know what? As Tony said earlier, God knows what we need. We just need to trust Him. And that's what I love about this entire series about the joy of fellowship. Because what we're able to do is able just to unite together through other means and encourage one another. And so what I would like for you to do this morning, as here we are, would you just throw in a comment, and maybe you want to encourage someone, maybe just say hello to someone. And so I'll start. So since I can't type right now, I know that our oldest is actually watching online right now. So Abney, and I think Kayla's with her right now because our other kids are doing their preteens kids church. So I just want to say hello to you. I believe my parents are watching. Sharon, I believe that you're watching. Just want to say hello. Our youth pastor, David Smith, what's up, buddy? We miss you guys. Just want to say hello. I think Bledsoe may be online. Just take an opportunity just to say hello to someone. I'm telling you, when you do this, just when you're able just to say hello or give them a word of encouragement like, hey, how are you doing, or hope all is well, it instantly adds almost to your entire joy. It boosts you. It just gives you a boost of encouragement. It's just like, yeah, you can go on. It's awesome. Because whenever we have the Word of God with us and we are united together through fellowship, by the Holy Spirit, we share a bond that's unlike any other. Because there's no glue like the Holy Spirit. There's nothing that can just bind us close together through the Holy Spirit. So tell someone hello this morning, or send them a message, whatever that looks like. Give them a phone call. Just, hey, how are you? I was thinking about you. Just, that's it. That's all you have to do. And don't let Satan play tricks on you and make you think that, oh, they're going to think bad of you, or I'm going to be bothering them. No. Give them a word of encouragement. Tell them hello. Tell them good morning. Because, church, this is what fellowship is all about. We are united by a common bond. It's Jesus. And what lives inside of each of us is the power of the Holy Spirit. And we are united. And whenever we are united like this, we just share this bond. And what we're able to do, we're able to encourage one another. Because right now around us, there is not only a lot of negativity, but there's a lot of things that we could harp on. You know, last week we may have been saying, man, it's cold, it's cold, it's cold. But yesterday, maybe you're complaining about it being too hot. There's always a way to look at something that you may be able to complain or view negatively. But what we're able to do as a group of people is that we're able to pour and invest each other, that we can see something positive we can rejoice over. Look at this psalm with me. This is in Psalm 118, verse 24. I like this. It says, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It doesn't say a day that is perfect conditions. It doesn't say a day without any barriers or hardships. Today is a day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. So what he's saying here about let us, it doesn't mean that it's in your favor. It is a choice to rejoice. I'm going to say that again. It is your choice to rejoice. You have that choice whether you're going to complain or rejoice. I love this. And he says, and be glad in it. My question to you is, what this morning do you have in your life? What is it that you can rejoice over? What is it that you could give God that praise? Now, if you were to look the definition of rejoice over, it's to feel great or show great joy or delight. What is something this morning? I know that we may have other things around us that may be dragging us down, but what is something that you can rejoice over? What about our health? What about the air that we breathe? What about the ability to have a roof over our heads? These are all things that maybe we take for granted, but we can rejoice over. Maybe you've got a good friendship or a healthy family. Maybe your marriage, you just That's something that you can rejoice. What is something you can rejoice over? Because I encourage you right now to take a moment and rejoice. Whether it be in one of the comments here, or just go ahead and just tell God, God, I'm thankful for. That's what rejoicing is to feel or show great joy or delight. What is something right now that you can rejoice over? Because we all have something that we can complain over. I'm saying, what's something you can rejoice over? Not the perfect day, not the perfect environment, not the perfect setting, not even the perfect car. Today is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Because, church, we've got something to rejoice over. And this is just like the disciples, because they themselves had something to rejoice over. We've been in the book of Acts talking about the disciples, and we're going to look at Acts chapter 2, and we're going to kind of see what the disciples did, because they had some things that they could focus on too, because they were on a roller coaster ride. And regardless of what's going on around you, you can rejoice. Regardless of things right now are in your favor or not, we can choose to rejoice. Because your choice is yours to rejoice or not. And the disciples had this same opportunity. You know, Jesus had just gotten done telling them, hey, I need you to go to Jerusalem and wait. So he died on the cross, he rose from the dead, and for 40 days he showed himself. And right before he ascended to heaven on that 40th day, he told the disciples, hey, I need you to go to Jerusalem and wait there for the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit. So they were commanded to go and wait, and so they did. And as we talked about last week and the week before, this Holy Spirit came down and it sat upon all of them. Now, look at verse 4. So they waited, and here's what they got. Verse 4. Then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different languages as the Spirit gave them ability for speech. So this Holy Spirit, that day they were all filled. They were all. And as we learned last week on Mother's Day talking about Mary, there were other people there too. So we know the disciples and others, they've got this Holy Spirit and they were all filled. And church, this is the part of fellowship that we've been talking about. Is that this fellowship that we have is more than just taking a right hand of fellowship at church. This Holy Spirit, it unites us. It bonds us. The blood of Jesus is greater than a building. And I think Tony did a great job this morning explaining that. We are the church regardless of where we're at. This is just a meeting place where we get to come together. And it rekindles us and it helps us. And I love this because we get the Holy Spirit. And so, just to kind of explain this, I've got several candles here, and this big candle, so this is the Holy Spirit that came down, and what it actually did is the Holy Spirit on that day, it came and it sat down upon all of them. And as it sat down upon all of them, they were, as according to the Scriptures, all filled. And because they were all filled, oh man, you're talking about a common bond. So, when you have something in common with someone else, what that does, it unites you. So the Holy Spirit came down, and it sat down upon all of them. Now, I've only got 6 candles here because, well, I didn't want to get a fire hazard. So we've only got 6 right here, but there were these disciples there, and there were many others, and they were all had this. In church, I've got 6 candles right here lit. And if I hold my hand about a foot above it, I can feel the heat, not from one candle, but from all of them. They are united in giving off this heat in this light. And church, that's exactly what happened on this day of Pentecost. They were all filled, all of them. They were all contributing to what was taking place. And look at what was taking place. They began to speak in different languages as the Spirit gave them the ability for speech. They began to speak and to preach. And what happened was, absolutely amazing. Look at verse 5. There were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, when this Holy Spirit came, a crowd came together and was confused because each one heard them speaking in his own language. And they were astounded and amazed, saying, look, aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? How is it that each of us here in our own native language. And you can read these next few verses. There are very many nations represented there, very many different languages. But they were united, and they were all giving off this language. They were all contributing. They were all speaking because the Holy Spirit was there. And it set each one of them on fire. It sat down on them, and they were lit. Now, church, this is very powerful. They were all there. They were all there. And here they were. They were filled, and a miracle was being performed. Because even though they were speaking their native language, the other people were able to have this interpretation. The Holy Spirit gave them this utterance, and they were just that they did not know. Now, this wasn't just any ordinary people either. This was devout men. This was not only religious people. This was upstanding people that were there. Very devout, and they heard them. Could you imagine the joy that this group was experiencing? I'm talking about this group. Church, there's something very powerful when you're in a group of people and everyone is working. Could you imagine the joy that they were experiencing? They were all contributing to this. Church, the only way that I can explain this is that growing up, whenever we were on the farm and we were working, if one of us was out there, we were all out there working. And I saw this in my own family. Just the other day, I was on the tractor, and then I saw, you know, my wife, she was out there with the hoe. I saw my kids out there. If one of us was out there, we were all out there. If one got to the end of the road, they would help finish the other row. There's just something whenever you can look and see, and everybody's contributing. Now, you tell me right here, which one of these candles, which one is contributing to the most heat? You can't tell because they're all contributing. So that's what I want you to understand about this joy of this fellowship that we have, is that we all have it and a part of it. And you talking about joy, it got some people talking. Look at verse 12. They were all astounded and perplexed, saying to one another, "What could this be? What is this that they..." This was devout people now. Devout men. What is this? What is this that they possess that we don't have? What is this that they got? And church, we know what it is. Church, it's Jesus. They had a full dose of Jesus. The Holy Spirit was sitting upon them, and it was astounding others. They possessed something. They possessed this joy of this fellowship through the Holy Spirit. And it caught others' attention. What could this be? What is this? I love that. And church, here's a part of this, that we're here, that we are joined together as believers to love one another, to support one another, to encourage one another. And as we do this, we all are growing closer to God. Now, which these candles, is one getting closer to God than the other? Church, when we're part of the fellowship, we move together. We move. They're all giving off this light. They're all giving off this heat. So we grow closer to God together, and we shine brightly in our communities and in our homes. Now, this is awesome. And I don't know about you, but this really does set me on fire. Because this was the plan for the church. Not the building. We're talking about the people. Up to this point, not one mention yet at all has been to a facility. It's all about the power and the moving of the Holy Spirit and the joy of their fellowship. Now, some people didn't like it. They began to mock them. Look at verse 13. But some sneered and said, "They are full of new wine." You see the exclamation point? They were really mocking them. This was loud, obnoxious, really just trying to bring them down. Now, don't you have some people in your life that sometimes do this to you? Here you are. You're a part of this group. You're part of this fellowship. You're doing your best to shine your light for God. And you got somebody go, "Ah, that wasn't God. Ah, that ain't nothing. Ah, you're just drunk." That's what they were telling them. They're just full of new wine. There's going to be people like that. Now, we have a choice that we can do. And sometimes we allow them to wet their fingers and put us out, and we're like, ah, maybe they're right, and we'll just start, maybe moving to the back, being a little bit more unseen, try to blend in. But there was one person who stood up. They were all here on fire, but there's one person who stepped to the front. Look, verse 14. But Peter stood up. Now, I wonder, why did Peter do this? Church, Peter had some joy. He had some joy. They were all a part of this group. He really had some joy, and they were all experiencing this. And Peter stood up. And I love this. He stood up with the 11. They were all there together, but all Peter did was step forward. I want you to understand this. See, the emphasis is always on Peter, but I want you to look at the group. They were together. Just as I was talking about our family being out on the farm together in the fields, they were together. The group was together. Peter stood up with them. He didn't outshine the others. He was with them. Church, this is the joy and the power of fellowship, that we have people in our lives that we can stand up with that will help us face whatever is in front of us. And who did Peter have to face? Oh, for the joy that was set before him, he set forth and raised his voice and proclaimed to them, "Men of Judah and all you residents of Jerusalem, let me explain this to you and pay attention to my words." I love this wording. "For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it's only 9 in the morning." He's defending his fellowship of believers. He's defending this. He says, "On the contrary, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel." And what he does is Peter brings to life the prophecy of the Old Testament, confirms who Jesus was, what he represented, and he explains what was taking place that day. Peter is a part of the fellowship. And together, they confront. Peter may be the voice, but together, they are confronting all of Jerusalem. That's who Peter addresses. I love this. You talk about some joy. Now, Peter had some joy. I believe all the disciples experienced some joy because why? They were filled with the Holy Spirit. In church, there is nothing like it. So he quoted and he preached. And you can keep on reading this and you can see Peter's message. But I want to skip down to verse 22 because he addresses them. He calls them out point blank. "Men of Israel, listen to these words. This Jesus, the Nazarene, was a man pointed out to you by God with these miracles, wonders and signs that God did among you through him, just as you yourselves know. Though he was not delivered up according to God's, though he was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people to nail him to a cross and kill him. God raised him up, ending the pains of death because it was not possible for him to be held by it." Church, here is someone that knew Jesus. And he was letting these joy robbers, he was letting these other people have it. Now, not in a condescending way, but he was just really pointing out that, no, they were wrong. This group was not filled with new wine. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. They had a dose of Jesus that others had not yet experienced. And Peter knew something about it. But wait a minute. Is this not the same Peter that just a few days prior to this had denied knowing Jesus? Remember, he said, "Jesus, I'll never deny you." And Jesus said, "Yeah, Peter, before the cock crows, you'll deny me 3 times. Sure enough, it happened. Peter knew Jesus. He also knew the forgiving power of Jesus. He also knew the forgiveness of sins. And right now, Peter has stepped forward and he is shining bright. Not by himself. Church, he is shining with the group. I love this. One does not get more glory than the other. They are all representing what? Jesus. We've all got the Holy Spirit. He may just be this one voice, but they are all playing a part. Let me put it to you this way. Here this morning, We have several people that's playing a part. We have Melanie and Lindsay who are able to teach our preteens, and they're doing that from home. We have Super Dave who is working audio, video stuff. We got Tony who does this intro. We got Wendy who is managing our live stream. We got Amanda who is managing our Facebook page. Church, we've got all this going on. We're all working. We're all a part of the group. We're all working. Everyone is shining. I just want you to see this, that we are part of the fellowship of church. This is the joy, because there's times in our lives that we need to rejoice. And sometimes we're going to have to address the naysayers among us. We're going to have to tell them to stop speaking so negatively into our lives. We can put a stop on that. Hey, I'm going to need you to stop doing that. We're going to need you to stop speaking that way. We're going to need you to stop using that language around us. Why? Because, church, we're part of this group so we can stand up against this. This is the joy of the fellowship. Because who had Peter's back? All these other disciples. They had his back. I love this. He was not alone. Not only did he have the Holy Spirit there, but he had the support of the group and allowed him to shine. I love this. And then he gets, you can keep on reading this, and I know that I'm skimming down through this, but look at verse 36. He uses this very powerful word, therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. And when they heard this, they came under deep conviction and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what must we do? Church, this is very powerful, and I never saw this until very recently. As we're studying for this, Peter's the one, he's a part of the group. He steps forward to speak. He gets to this point, this is like the conclusion, the climax of his message, and he says the word therefore. He puts out this great word. They fall under conviction, and look at who the convicted, look at who the crowd addresses. Look, we skimmed over it. They said to Peter and the rest of the apostles. Peter didn't get any other glory from this. The group did, because they're all a part of the fellowship. And church, this is the joy of fellowship, is that we are not alone. We've got people in the trenches with us that not only have our backs, but that will pray for us, encourage us, support us, and help us to shine. Help us to shine. We need people in our lives that will help us point out and recognize the joy that we have, so that we can do what Psalm 118 verse 24 said. Today is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. People that can point out to us and help us recognize God's goodness when the rest of the world and people around us want us to see all the bad. We have people, we need people in our life that can redirect our eyes to the cross, that we may see Jesus and all his goodness instead of Satan and all of his lies. And they are just that, lies. Church, over the past few weeks, I know that sometimes our focus and our attention has been redirected and drawn towards things that are negative. And church, it's going to be a constant battle. Now, Peter, he experienced something great right here. Look at verse 38. Look at what greatness here. Repent, Peter said to them. He's still a part of the group, but again, he's this voice, and he says, repent and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you, I love this, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You will become what? A part of the fellowship. Repent, be baptized, join this fellowship. Churches is very powerful because it is an open invitation for this fellowship to grow. Verse 39, for the promise is for you, and for your children, and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord God will call. And with many other words, he testified and strongly urged him, saying, be safe from this corrupt generation. Church, this group right here, we don't know the exact number that was there, but this group that was there, and you can keep reading to the end of chapter 2, and what you're going to see is, this group all giving off heat, all contributing, all speaking, all preaching, all testifying, this group grows to 3,000. 3,000. That's the power and the joy of fellowship. Church, I'm telling you, when we have the Holy Spirit that unites us and we are part of this fellowship, there is nothing like it. Because walls cannot contain it. Satan cannot stop it. Viruses cannot hinder it. It only grows. It only grows. I love this. Peter steps forward and he was able to do this. Other people may try to stomp out his joy. And maybe there's people in your life that are trying to stomp out your joy. Church, it's time for us to redirect our focus, our attention on Jesus. Church, when you do that, you're going to view things in your life differently. You'll begin to start looking at things that being half full versus half empty. You'll start looking at things that happen in your life and, well, okay, God, what can I learn from this? How can I help? How can I contribute to the group? Don't let Satan tell you that you ain't got nothing to contribute, because you do. If you're saved, you got the Holy Spirit and you contribute. What we need to do is start rejoicing. Today is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Church, sometimes you need to choose to rejoice. Because things are not always going to go in your favor. I love this, because Acts chapter 2, we're seeing this. They're full of the Holy Spirit. They're speaking. They're teaching. Peter has this great message. And I want you to understand, everybody else is speaking too. Peter's just giving the conclusion here. You might as well say there's an altar call. 3,000 people get saved and baptized. And there is a fellowship that's joined there. Look at the end of Acts chapter 2 when you have a moment. There's a fellowship that's uniting them. But then what happens? You see in Acts chapter 3, Peter and John, two of them, they're going to the temple. And as they're going, there's a man here who's lame. He asks Peter and John for some money. And Peter says, we ain't got none, but what I do have, I'm going to give you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And he did. And he went with them. He joined the fellowship and went with them to church. Well, what happens is that people get excited. They hear this miracle, and church, it just starts growing and growing and growing. Well, then what ends up happening is that people don't like it. People don't like it. And what they're starting to do is that they get Peter and John, and they throw them in prison. So Peter and John are going to worship, and what happens there? They find themselves in prison overnight. And then they come to him, and they said, listen, guys, we're going to release you, but don't ever speak any more of this man Jesus. And Peter says again, he's a part of the group, a part of the fellowship. They're there. Peter and John's there together. And they said, but we cannot help but speak of the things of which we've seen and heard. We've got something to rejoice over. He didn't harp or complain about being in prison. Instead, church, he rejoices. Church, my question to you is very simple. This morning, I'm going to ask you again, what do you have in your life to rejoice over? Because the part of this fellowship is that we all work together under the unity of the Holy Spirit to further and expand the kingdom. Now, this morning, you're part of the fellowship. Are you encouraged? What do you have to rejoice over? I understand things may not be in your favor. Things wasn't in Peter and John's favor. They found themselves in prison after just having 3,000 people saved and baptized. Man, what a just a glorious opportunity that was, and to seeing that experience. But in the next chapter, it didn't go in their favor. All they did was heal the man. They found themselves in prison overnight. Doesn't seem fair, does it? It's the thing about life. And sometimes it's not fair. The church, I assure you, God has not changed. He has not changed. Sometimes we just need to realign our focus with Jesus and choose to rejoice. There's negative things that's going to come your way, but you have the opportunity to rejoice. And there's going to be other opportunities. As we rejoice, as we're a part of this fellowship, there's going to be other opportunities that you will experience, that you will have before you, just like this group, that you will be able to take a step forward and shine. Let your light shine. So my question this morning is twofold. One, what do you have to rejoice over? What is it that you can look out and you can just start praising God over? Because church, that needs to be the attitude of your heart. And it is contagious. Church, it's contagious. When people start coming to me and complaining, all I have to do is start redirecting the attention back to something positive, and instantly things change. Now there's a few people that are just sour people. And I just go ahead and prepare myself that that's just the way that they are. But and I'm not going to let it drag me down. I choose to rejoice. The question is, do you? Can you rejoice this morning? Even though people may try to damper you, can you rejoice? If you find yourself this morning having a hard time to rejoice, that's an indication that something is not right. Now you look at Peter, John, all these disciples. They had reason not to rejoice. I mean, they thought, they really expected Jesus to set up his kingdom right then. But no, Jesus thought, no, it's not now. It's later. It's for eternity. This is the right now. You're to spread this joy. You're supposed to spread this fellowship. Go and spread it. They had an excuse for not choosing joy, but they did choose joy. And when other people confronted them about it, what did they do? They didn't get sucked in. Instead, they approached them. Peter stood up with the group. And church, I cannot explain to you how vital it is that you be a part of a fellowship, a church. And right now, our fellowship is through online. That's why I encourage you to talk back and forth. Say hello to someone. Give a shout out. Encourage each other. There's different emojis and praise hands, things that you can do. However you can interact, do so. Because we are a part of the fellowship and we all contribute. No matter how great or small you may see that, you are a part of the fellowship. We are all the Holy Spirit. We have it inside of us. In church, I'm feeling the heat just from these six candles. And when we have a group of people that support us and encourage us to help bring out the best in us, that we may rejoice and we may approach others, church, it is life-changing. So I'm not sure what you may be going through right now in your life. But it's time that we rejoice. That regardless of things are in our favor or not, we rejoice. And recognize that we are a part of a group. That one person is not greater than the other. One person may shine a little different, but we all give off the heat. Again, I ask you this morning, what do you have this morning you can rejoice over? Because this needs to be the attitude of your heart. I mean, could you imagine what would happen in your life this week that it'd be so contagious that you're rejoicing, that the people that you encountered, whenever you hear a negative comment, you turn that around to something joyful. Church, could you imagine what happened if we gave off this joy, that we rejoiced no matter what was transpiring or going on? Could you imagine how contagious that would be? How that would spread? Church, it would spread more than what yawns do. You know how a yawn does. You see somebody yawn, and no matter how hard, you start yawning. Sometimes, even if you hear the word yawn, you'll immediately, it'll trigger something in your head, and you'll start yawning. Church, it's more contagious than that if we choose to rejoice. That we share our experiences with others. And maybe if you're here today, man, I'm just struggling about finding joy. I'm just struggling about choosing joy. I don't always do this, but I want to read this in a footnote of my Bible in Psalms 118, verse 24. And I think this is a really good explanation of how some of us may feel. Listen, this is not the Bible. This is in my footnotes, okay? There are days when the last thing that we want to do is rejoice. Our mood is low. Our situation is out of hand. Our sorrow and our guilt overwhelming. We can relate to the writers of the Psalms who often tell us that they feel this way. But no matter how low the psalmist felt, they were always honest with God. And as they talked to God, their prayers ended in praise. When you don't feel like rejoicing, tell God how you truly feel, and you will find that God will give you a reason to rejoice. Church, I want to close on this. There's going to be times in your life that you're not going to feel like rejoicing. And I think that's okay. But it's not okay to stay that way. Tell God how you feel. Tell God of your situation. Tell God of your experiences and what you're going through. And as you do, church, your focus and attention is getting set upon Him. And you're talking about rejoicing. Because we have something to rejoice over. And as we rejoice, we have the opportunity to step forward and to shine. So this message is twofold. One, what do you have to rejoice over? And two, who can you shine your light to? Who is it that you can be like Peter and step forward and shine your light to? Church, maybe it's to invite somebody to church online. We're going to be meeting online for the next few weeks. As we kind of take it slow and allow God to lead us and guide us through this, some churches are opening the doors and some are being very cautious, and we're just being very cautious. Maybe you can invite somebody to church online. Maybe it's to give somebody an encouraging word at the grocery store. Maybe it's to do something for somebody else, and that was the challenge from last week, that you would make it a point to encourage someone. Maybe you need to take it a step further, whether it be fix someone a meal, write someone a letter, give them a thank you card. How is it that you can contribute to somebody's joy? That you may shine. And church, I believe that if the church, if us as the church would use our choice to rejoice, church, it would be a world changer. Because instead of focusing on negativity and things that don't go our way, things that we may not like, we can choose to find the joy that's to be found. And when we do that, oh, as a part of a group, oh man, you're talking about feeling the heat. Church, it'll spread. Will you add to the contribution? Will you add to this fellowship? And you choose to rejoice and spread that out? Church, it's life-changing. And I believe with all my heart that God is asking you to join in what He's working on right now. Spreading the joy of Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, we love You and we thank You for this day that You've given to us. Today is a day that You have made. Church, we will rejoice and be glad in it. And I understand, Father, that sometimes we have to choose to rejoice, that there's so many things that can go negatively against us, but that we can choose joy. We can choose to rejoice. And God, this morning, that is what we choose. That when things come against us and don't go our way, we choose to rejoice. Help us, God, as we rejoice, that we just praise You for what You've done and what You're going to do. And whether things go in our favor or not, You are there. As you continue to pray, you may be experiencing something this morning. You may be going through something these past couple weeks, and you need someone to pray for you because your joy is on the line. Though there's been so many things come against you that you are experiencing hardships and that there's joy robbers all around you, may we have the opportunity to pray for you. I want to give you a couple different things that you can do here. For one, you can post it on there to pray for me. And because we've got people that are going to take the opportunity to pray for you. So if that's you, if you would be so bold to share that on there too, hey, please pray for me. Pray for me. Maybe some of you don't really feel comfortable posting that online. So I'm going to ask you something even bolder. That from in your homes or wherever you're at right now, would you just raise your hand and leave that raised? Because I can't see it, but God can. I'm going to pray for you. But would you be bold and say, hey, I need you to pray for me? Because my joy is on the line. My joy is being tested. And I need to choose to rejoice. I want to pray for you in this joy and your experiences. Let's pray together right now. Father, we love You and we thank You for hearing these words and knowing the heart and condition that we are experiencing. And right now, Father, You are seeing hands raised that need, Father, Your touch, that they may experience Your joy, that they may choose to rejoice. God, help them as they go through these experiences, no matter how negative, that they can choose this joy. And Father, this is a part of the joy of the fellowship, that we have people in our lives that can encourage us and help us. And God, may we feel that encouragement this morning, that we are not alone, that there's others that sometimes get weary, God, maybe we look to the Psalms and we can find so many different authors to talk about going through the valley of the shadow of death, but yet they're choosing joy because you're with them. May you lead us and guide us, God, as we go through life and navigate through these experiences, that we rejoice regardless of the situations that we face. As you continue to pray, there's some of you here this morning, and what you need to do is you need to kind of step out like Peter. You've got a group of people that love you and that support you, that encourage you. You may need to step out like Peter and be a light for your family. I want to pray for you, whoever you are, that you need to stand out. Maybe there's some things that you need to address. Peter addressed this group of people. They were devout people, yet Peter addressed them. Maybe there's some things in your life, maybe someone at work, maybe some issues going on, whatever it is that you need to step forward and to shine, to be a light. I want to pray for you. You know who you are. God, I pray for those that need to take this step forward like Peter to rejoice and address these group of people. God, I pray that you would just speak to them clearly. They may know their role. And I know, God, that sometimes we try to focus so much on what to say and how to say it. But I believe with all my heart that as we get close to you, when we face these situations, you will lead us. God, we pray for those that need to take a step forward to address the joy robbers, to address those that need to rejoice. God, that you would just help them. Fill them up, God, with your Holy Spirit, that they may be able to stand bold and strong for you. Because, Father, you're not done yet. This world needs Jesus. And right now, Father, we are the light. Help us to shine bright. God, no matter where we're going, no matter where we're at, no matter what we're experiencing, no matter what our work is doing, help us, Father, to shine bright. Not one over the other, but just that together we will all contribute to the spreading of this joyous news. That God so loved this world that he sent his Son. That we may have life, everlasting life. And this is the good news of the gospel that is to be found. Help us this week, Father, that we can share this joy. We're a part of the fellowship. Help us, God, this week that we may share this joy unto others. That they may see Jesus, this life, in us. God, we pray again for all of our nation and its leaders, all of our places of work, all of our churches, God, that you would just lead us to make wise decisions and to follow under your leadership. God, we pray for all those in healthcare that still face them with the front lines of this. I pray for every family, Father, no matter what they're going through, experiencing, that together we will rejoice. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.